All right, good evening, everyone. We are safe and sound from the gust of winds outside. It's pretty crazy out there. So thank you for joining us tonight. If we could open in a word of prayer before we get started. Father, we thank you so much for today. We thank you for this time and the opportunity to be in your house in the middle of this week. God, I pray that your spirit would just be present among us, just moving within us, readying us for the receiving of your word, and God, for the freedom to just worship and proclaim your name. And so, Father, we invite you to be here. And God, would you see us and be satisfied with what you see and with what you hear? We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This is my song. perfect submission, the perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my side. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. 'Cause this is my story. Perfect submission, and all is at rest. I am my Savior, am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's a word that will bless your heart. 'Cause I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper breath. 'Cause I'll bring you more than a song, worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
Father, we thank you so much for this time. God, it is truly all about you. And so, Father, would you anoint your word tonight. God, allow us to have a greater perspective. God, give us the eyes to see and ears to hear. Father, we ask that you would just, you'd have your way with us tonight. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good evening, everyone. I hope the Lord finds you well this Wednesday evening that is very, very windy. If you have gathered to study the Word of God, you are in the right place. If you have come expecting something else, sorry for you. That is what we do on Wednesday nights, is we try to do our best to dig deep into our Scripture. And tonight we are doing the same, right? We are continuing our deep dive into the waters of James's letter, right? A book I believe that everyone in this room and a lot of people watching this are very familiar with, right? And what our goal is, right, just a reminder, our goal is to take that familiarity and be reminded of God's faithfulness and things we've learned in the past while simultaneously digging deeper into the text to learn new things and gain a greater perspective of what James is addressing in his letter and how that it can apply to our lives. And so one of the themes we encounter in the book of James is how people are to act, right? Like the mannerism in which we present ourselves and in the way that we interact with those around us, right? We are looking, when we look at James, we see how we are to act as people of faith. And while James, on a surface level, can be a great book to kind of learn like Christian morals, right? Kind of like some mannerisms, I believe it shouldn't be limited to just that, right? So when we look at the book of James, like, yes, there's going to be some things, some do's and don'ts, and things that you're going to want to apply to your life. But I do believe that there is a lot more to be understood, right? Because James is one of those books that calls for us to look at ourselves and the lives that we are living, the actions we are displaying, and to become more mindful and intentional about them as we take the words of Christ, the instructions of Scripture, and allow that to transform the way that we live as a result of the gospel we have received, right? So everything that James is presenting, everything that James is communicating, comes from a heart as we as a people know who Jesus is, right? We have heard the gospel, and we have in some capacity have responded to the gospel. And what James is urging his readers, right, and exiled Christians and so forth, is to take a real look at their lives and to see how that lines up with the things that they apparently believe and confess with their mouth, with their hearts, and with their lives. And so at this intersection in James, we are transitioning out of the various trials of life and the call to persevere through the testing of our faith, right? To be mindful of how we interact with Scripture and how we react to it with our minds, hearts, and living, right? So we're moving past the trials of life, the trials of faith, or the things that test our faith and produce perseverance and so forth. And we're beginning to look at how we are to act as a people who have been saved by grace, okay? So with that said, let us go ahead and look at our scripture tonight. We're going to be looking at James chapter 1, verses 19 through 21. It's only three verses, but I do believe that there's a lot to understand and identify with. So if you can stand with me and give ear to God's living word this evening. Starting with verse 9, this is what James continues to address. He says, "Know this, my beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls." Amen. All right, you may be seated. Now, I'd imagine that this is a very familiar passage for most of you. And for me personally, traditionally, whenever I would come across this particular place in Scripture, whether it be in my own study or quiet time or through the receiving of God's Word through a sermon, oftentimes the emphasis is really placed on our interactions with others. Right? Does it make sense? Like, so the way that it's usually presented, the way that's kind of given to us is that we are to be quick to listen to others, right? We are to be slow to speak. In other words, we're to listen and we're to think twice before speaking and to put the cherry on top. Please, please, please do not react or respond out of anger. And if you were to read that in James, and that would be your takeaway, like, it's a great word, right? It's great advice, and listening to that, I believe, will take you far in life and in your relationship with others and even your interaction with people, right? If you were to take what we just said and apply that to your lives, you will spend most of your life not apologizing but enjoying the company of others. Because if you flip the script, then you're going to be spending a lot of time apologizing and a lot of time trying to mend some of the relationships and interactions that you may have messed up along the way. However, James actually addresses the importance of being slow to speak in chapter 3, right? And so here, while that does apply to our living, I believe that's really just grazing the surface. And what I mean by that is, if that is our takeaway, that these are some morals that we can apply to our life, then we're just grazing the surface. But aren't you curious what's beneath the surface? I believe there's things to discover, because when we look at verse 21, which we will study more in depth a little later in our study tonight, it actually gives us a clear indication of what James means when he addresses the things he does. And he says what? That this, all of this, right, is to receive the implanted word which is able to save your souls. And so the advice that he's giving, or things that he's addressing, it isn't about our interaction with others, per se, but it begins with our interaction and with our receiving of what? God's word. And so just to have the mentality and have the mindset as we study our word is actually going to change the kind of the trajectory, right? Because understanding that direction should dictate how we interpret and how we receive what James is addressing in the verses leading up to verse 21. I hope that makes sense, right? You see, James, what James is doing, James is steering us in the direction of seeing and understanding how we are to receive God's word, his instructions, his requirements, and how we as a people are to respond to God's word. And so this isn't just about mannerisms, but this is really about the posture of our heart when we are hearing, listening, and receiving the word of God, okay? And so, Deepak, that's too late, man. We already passed it, brother. All right, so starting with verse 19, we see James address every person, right? Believe it or not, whoever would hear the word of God should be quick to hear. But what does it mean to be quick to hear? Right, being quick to hear means we are to be attentive. And the Greek word used to describe quick is tachus, right? Tachus or tachus.
right? And then suggest that there should be this swiftness, that when you are hearing, that there should be this sense of urgency, right? Takus is also used to actually refer to Jesus' second coming in the sense that it is coming sooner rather than later. Right? So when we refer to the Jesus' second coming, it's not like, hey man, we have all the time in the world. No, but we anticipate Jesus' second coming because it can happen at any moment. And our hope, right? And scripture warns us that we should be ready because he's going to come like a thief in the night. Right? Jesus is going to be, he's going to come. He's going to come swiftly. So that, right? And so that means being quick to hear isn't something to take lightly. Or when it comes to the word of God and the gospel, it isn't something that we should be putting off, right? We shouldn't be wasting time not listening. If anything, we should be ready at a moment's notice, right? We should be ready. We should prepare ourselves. And so we can all agree that being quick to hear is something that is important, right? It's not something to take lightly. It's not something to think of as secondary. This is something that is a primary goal for us as followers of Christ. And so as important being quick to hear is, how we hear is also of great importance, right? We are told to be quick to hear, but how we get that ready or how we get that into motion is also of great importance. Right? Charles Spurgeon says, because it is by the word that we are begotten, let us be swift to hear it. Right? Because it is by the word that we are begotten, right? But we are saved, that we are redeemed. That's how we have faith, right? Let us be swift to hear it. And even in the first part of Luke chapter 8, verse 18, Jesus says, take care then how you hear. And so if we are to be quick to hear, if we're to be quick to listen, then it's equally important for us to come from a place of preparation that allows me to hear in the way that Jesus is requiring me to hear, right? Our environment or even the company we have when we hear the word of God matters, right? Does that make sense? So for example, when it comes time to, I don't know, read your Bible, when it comes time for you to do quiet time, right? Are you going to have the TV on blazing loud? Are you going to have music blasting like that to a point where it's distracting, right? While you're trying to read and study? When you're trying to read this, when you're trying to read scripture, are you going to, I don't know, be on the phone or have a conversation with another individual about something that does not relate as you're trying to read? And while I understand that there are some people who are really good at multitasking, right? The question I ask is, why would you want to divert some of your attention away from something that desires your full attention? You see, it's important for us to establish a good environment for yourself when you are trying to be quick to hear. Or another scenario that we could utilize is, I don't know, being at church or when it's Sunday worship or even Wednesday night or whatever, right? The goal, right, the intention of coming to church, especially on a Sunday, is that you're coming with the mindset, with the mentality to sing in adoration with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, and you are there to hear the word of God being preached to you. Right now, would you be able to pay attention and get the most out of the message with somebody constantly, I don't know, whispering in your ear, nudging you, making comments, talking about things that are not related to the message? Right? Maybe, but it wouldn't be ideal. And the more that that person talks to you, the more you're drawn away from the message into whatever conversation that person is creating. You see, it becomes difficult to have an attentive spirit when you're being distracted and as disruptions take place. Right? The word of God isn't being heard in your life. It is being hindered. In scripture, right, James is communicating to us, we need to be quick to hear. Right? Not to the problems of other people, but when it pertains to scripture, we need to be quick to hear. And part of the responsibility for believers in response to being quick to hear is ensuring that we are in a position to be able to hear and to be able to receive the word of God. And so if that's of importance, if that is the goal, if that should be our mentality, if that should be our posture, then it's about establishing an environment to adequately hear. It's about being able, it's about being around others who care to hear what the Lord says. And so if we want to study the Word of God, if we want to be quick to hear, and we're having a conversation that pertains to that, great. But if it is something that is distracting, then that is preventing us, right? It is creating a roadblock from us hearing and receiving the Word of God. And James's warning or James's urge for the churches to be quick to hear. But we can't be quick to hear if we have all of this other outside noise. We can't not hear if we are saying, well, I'm gonna read the Word of God, but then my eyes are wandering, my thoughts are wandering elsewhere. Right? It is important for us as people of faith to create an environment that surrounds us, that allows us to hear the Word of God. Right? Because James says, let every person be quick to hear. The second thing that we're told is that we're told to be slow to speak. And for some of you in this room, you can learn a lot from that. Or you've been told, or you've been quoted this Bible verse many, many times. Right? Be slow to speak. It might be out of context, right? But it's worked. So generally, when we think of slow to speak, our understanding is to think twice before speaking. Or if you're my mother always tells me, think three times before you speak. Because when I was younger, my mouth got me into some trouble, if you know what I mean, right? And yes, right, it's about holding our tongue. It's about refraining from saying something when we could say something. And if this were in relation to our interaction with others, right, this would be very useful information. But what about in the context of what this is being written? Right, but what about when the call is to be slow to speak when you are hearing the Word of God? Right, because this isn't talking about our interaction with others. We get to that in James 3. This is in relation to when we are hearing and receiving the Word of God. And so if you're trying to understand this from the perspective of hearing and receiving the Word of God, then being slow to speak means providing enough time in between hearing the Word of God and actually allowing it to speak to you before responding, before making comments and coming to your own conclusions and so on. Because the problem is because oftentimes what happens when it comes to something that we've heard before is, as you're hearing it, and maybe you are guilty of this tonight, right? That as you are hearing it and it's familiar, our first instinct and our first reaction is to say something along the lines of, oh, I've heard this before. I've heard this many times before, Pastor Frankie. Oh, I already know what he is going to say. Oh, I already know what that means. Right? Maybe you can relate, especially when it comes to something like James. But the problem that we have with that and why Scripture addresses that is because when that happens, right, when we already make the decision or when we already say, oh, I already know what's going to be said, or I already know the point of this message, or I already know what the Scripture says about this particular verse or whatever, that reaction begins to dictate and determine how we are going to hear the Word and how we're going to receive it. Does that make sense? And so you might say, like, Pastor Frankie, what's the problem with that? The problem with that, the issue with that is that when we do that, when we come with that mentality, when we have that heart, when we have that mindset, we are not allowing room for the Holy Spirit to guide us and to really convict us. Instead, we say, you know what, I already know what's going on. And so our hearts get blocked off. Our minds are not open to what might be said because we are already drawing our conclusions. And the problem with that is we become the ones steering the ship when we need the Holy Spirit to be the one guiding us. That is why James is saying, be slow to speak. Because if you are saying a lot of these things in relation to people who have been raised, right, in the laws of Judaism, and now they've come to know Christ, well, a lot of things they've heard, they say, well, I already know that. Well, I've heard that ever since I was a young kid. Oh, I was raised in that. And the problem with that is that we prevent ourselves from being in a place where God is able to speak to us, where we are able to see things that God wants to reveal to us, okay? And so here, the Greek word for slow is braudus, right? And braudus means to take a long time, right? It means to be unhurried. It means to even deliberate. And once you have all the facts, to move forward, right? And where we go wrong is, we move forward too fast. Right? Like I said, we already jumped to our conclusions. We jump to the end of the story. We jump and say, well, I already know what he's going to say. It's kind of like when someone begins to ask a question, and before the person can finish asking the question, you think you know the answer. And so you start to speak, not knowing the full question in its entirety. And what ends up happening is you end up answering the question wrong, right? Maybe you've been there before, and that's because you didn't produce, all right? You didn't slow your roll. You see, it's in our pride. It's in our, even in our confidence, that we can be so quick to speak as if we got it. It's because we can be so impulsive that being slow to speak is to our benefit. Right? James is saying, like, hey, slow it down. Hey, yeah, you've heard this before. But because of the things that you have gone through in life, because of what you have experienced in life, this may speak to you differently. Right? We have to not only provide an environment that allows us to be quick to hear, but we also have to come with the posture that is slow to speak. In other words, I'm quiet so that the Holy Spirit can speak. Right? It is a call for us to restrain ourselves. And it's not necessarily a call for us to bite our tongues, but it's a call for us to allow adequate time for God's word to sit not only in our minds, but in our hearts and to marinate so that we as a people can be discerning of what God is doing in our lives. Right? Broadus is a call for us to slow down and prevent ourselves from reacting hastily, because that will get us into trouble, or that might make us miss the point, or that might make us miss some details that God is trying to reveal to us along the way. You see, when we fail to be slow to speak, we put ourselves at a disadvantage when it comes to hearing the word of God in the ways that God desires for us to hear it, right? So in Jeremiah chapter 5, verse 21, the Lord actually warns the people of Israel. He says, hear this, O foolish and senseless people, who have eyes but see not, who have ears but hear not. You see, when we fail to be slow to speak, it is as if we have eyes that are able to see but cannot see what God desires for us to see. That's a problem. Right? We see what we want to see. But the reality of the situation, especially when it comes to us, when it pertains to us as people of faith, we need to see from God's perspective. We need to take notice to the things that God desires for us to see and experience. And the same thing could be said about the ears, right? Ears that can hear loud and clear, we have them, but we're unable to hear the things that God wants us to hear. Why? Because we fail to be slow to speak. Oftentimes, we become so quick to speak. We become so quick to respond. And like we mentioned earlier, once again, environment is important. And in this case, our posture is important. The way that we are presenting ourselves, the way that we were looking and longing to hear God's word. We as people need a posture of humility and one that is longing to hear, learn, and be led. So the third thing that we encounter, right, from be quick to hear, slow to speak, the last one is slow to anger, right? James says that we need to be slow to anger. And once again, right, when you're dealing with people, this advice goes a long ways. But our angle is understanding this from the perspective of hearing and receiving God's word. And so from that angle, what would cause us to hear God's word and be bothered by it? For me, it seemed kind of odd. Like I can't think of many times where I've read scripture and I've walked away upset. Right? I can't think of any. Right? And praise the Lord that, you know, all things that were unclean have been made clean. Right? So we get to enjoy those foods. Right? But other than that, I can't think of anything that makes me look at scripture and causes me to be upset. But the more that I sat on it, I think God allowed me to be reminded of the parable of the young rich man who asked Jesus, what must I do to inherit the kingdom of God? And after Jesus told him what he needed to do, he left. Right? The Bible says he left sad, but one has to believe that a part of him was upset because in his mind, he did everything he was supposed to do. When Jesus said, did you do this, do that, and that, he said, yeah, I did all those things. And then Jesus gave him the final instruction, right, to sell all his possessions. And he couldn't do it. And so if I put myself in that situation, in that scenario, well, guess what? I'd be upset too, right? That would be my initial reaction. That would have been my state of emotions in the heat of the moment. And now we don't know if this young rich ruler's heart changed after some time and things settled down and after he heard about, you know, Jesus dying on the cross and all those things, right? Maybe we'll find out in heaven, right? Who knows? But the point for us is realizing how being slow to anger can prevent us from making rash decisions and reacting out of our emotions when we should be reacting in discernment. A lot of times we read scripture emotionally and we just walk away. But I do believe that we need to discern, right? We need to be slow to speak and we need to be slow to anger. We need to be slow to move. And Proverbs chapter 14, verse 29, right, it says, whoever is slow to anger has great understanding. Right? Whoever is slow to anger has great understanding. Why? Because the word of God is what? Is resting in their hearts. The word of God is marinating in their hearts. The word of God is at work in their hearts. And they are allowing themselves to see things not from their own personal perspective or jump to their conclusions, but they are waiting on the Lord. Right? Whoever is slow to anger has great understanding, but he who has a hasty temper exalts folly. You see, our understanding changes. Our understanding widens. Our understanding increases when we are slow to anger, when we allow the word of God to do what it needs to do in our lives. But we can't jump ahead, right? We can't say, oh, I already know that. Right? We can't jump ahead and say, I already know where you're going to go with this, Pastor Frankie. Right? We cannot come with that with such confidence. Right? And we'll get to a little bit later. We need to come with more of a meekness. So when we get to verse 20, James says, for the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. And this anger that James is referring to isn't the kind of anger you feel in the spur of the moment. Right? This isn't the kind of anger that you get when somebody, I don't know, cuts you off when you're driving. Right? This isn't that kind of anger. This anger that James is referring to is a kind of anger that boils up and it builds up over time. It's a frustration that wrestles within us. And the Greek word here for anger is orge, right? And it is considered to be a persistent anger. It is an anger with inner deep resentment that spreads and smolders, right? It's kind of like a viral infection, right? Just it just spreads all over. Scripture describes it, or the, you know, Greek commentary describes it as this image of swelling up, only to implode, only to burst, to explode. And James says that this kind of anger fails to produce the righteousness of God. Why is that? Why would something like this prevent us from producing the righteousness of God? Why would this prevent us from growing up in faith? Why would this kind of anger prevent us from continually cultivating and maturing the relationship that we have with Jesus Christ? And the answer is that a holy life never grows out of an angry spirit. But what does anger produce in our lives? In my experience, it produces bitterness. And what does, you know, and bitterness will never make us any better. It only makes us more angry, right? Having this anger rest in us produces grudges. It will develop a heart that fails to forgive. It will develop a heart that will fail to be merciful. Right? And it will just build up and up in our lives when it goes unresolved. Right? And I'm sure we can all agree that anger can be toxic. And if you've ever had that kind of anger just kind of rest and boil up in your life, everything makes you angry, right? Or the sight of happiness makes you angry, right? The sight of being, I don't know, happy for somebody else makes you angry. And James is saying that this kind of anger does not produce the righteousness of God. If anything, it robs us from that growth. That is why it's so important for us to be slow to anger. Because I believe that when we are slow to anger, what happens? We realize just how stupid we can be. We realize just how foolish we can be. When we allow the dust to settle, we realize just why there's no reason to be that angry. When we are slow to anger, we see the necessity for forgiveness. And when it pertains to our own lives, we see the necessity for repentance. And so Charles Spurgeon actually gives us a good remedy to the situation. Right? He says, there is a tendency to grow angry with those who do not see the truth. But it is not a foolish thing to be angry with blind men because they do not see. What if you see yourself? Who opened your eyes? Give God the promise for what you see and never think that your anger, your indignation, your hot temper can ever work the righteousness of God. It is contrary thereto and cannot work towards it. Right? And that kind of sets us up for verse 21, right? Because, and that's what we're going to be wrapping up our time with. But James says this. He says, therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness, and our anger be accredited to the wickedness. And he says, receive with meekness the implanted word of God, or the implanted word which is able to save your souls. But the key word that we'll get to in just a second is meekness. But he says, before we get to meekness, there's two things that you need to get rid of. And the first one is filthiness. Right? And some translations say, get rid of all filthiness. And the filth that James is referring to is one that is commonly associated with the dirtying of our clothes or the things that kind of soils our body. And, you know, we all get dirty in all different ways, shapes, and forms. And so whatever your filthiness is or whatever causes you to be soiled, you need to get rid of that. Because what dirties me may not dirty you, right, in some general sense. Right? Obviously, there's a lot of things that if it'll dirty me, it'll dirty you, right? Yes, that's true. But there's certain things that might dirty me, but it won't affect you. But James is saying, you have to get rid of all of that. And when put into the context of what has been addressed, it is our moral filth, or the thing that kind of leads us into this deep, dark water. Well, interesting enough, right, one commentary tried making the connection from of ruparia and it being a derivative of rupos, and it's all referring to filth, right? But I guess rupos, when used in a medical sense, refers to the wax that develops in your ear. And so it's just possible that it still retains that meaning here, right? That James is telling his readers to get rid of everything which would stop their ears from hearing the true word of God, right? When wax gathers in ears, right, it can make a man deaf, or it can irritate, and it makes life uncomfortable. And a man's sin can make him deaf to God. I thought that was cool. I thought that was interesting. Nonetheless, right, we need to get rid of the filth. We need to get rid of the rampant wickedness. Right? Our wickedness is what defiles us. We all know that. It's our depravity. We know it's bad. We know it's not good for us. So we need to lose it. But the last thing we need to pay attention to is how we receive the word of God. Yes, we need to be quick to listen. Yes, we need to be slow to speak. And yes, we need to be slow to anger. But what I can't get over, and I think it's so important for us to pay attention to, is that when we receive the word of God, we need to receive it with meekness. And I think the easiest way to describe this is having a posture that says, I need to hear this. Or I need to receive it. Or what God has to say to me applies to me. Or maybe our posture needs to say, I need to hear this as if I'm hearing it for the first time. But when we receive the word of God, our posture, this meekness that James describes, is one that says, God has something to teach me. God has something he wants to reveal to me. God has something he wants me to see. And because I know God to be a God, the God who loved me and has saved me, I will listen intently. I will clear my environment to remove all distractions, because I know that what I need to receive or what I need to hear is of the utmost importance in my life. Yes, we can look at James in this particular section and think these are great moral tools. We can think that these are things that are great for our interactions with others. It's going to help our relationship with people. And yes, that is true, right? If you would apply these three things, it will serve you well and allow you to go far in your friendships, in your relationships, and even in your own marriages. But when it pertains to the Word of God, the thing that is the most of most importance to us, even though we've heard it, even though we've been here before, even though we've already studied it, our posture, our heart needs to have one of humility, one that lays down our pride, one that lays down our knowing, one that lays down our knowledge, one that lays down our wisdom, one that even lays down our own expertise and says, God, you are my teacher. Have your way with me. And so at times there's reason for us to be quick. And at other times there's reason for us to be slow. And when it pertains to our teacher, when it pertains to our Lord and Savior, we should continually fixate our posture toward him in a way that desires to know him more, that desires to live for him more, and one that desires to be able to see and know life from the way that he sees it through his eyes as he is bestowing that unto us. And so, church, my brothers and sisters, would you receive the word that is able to save your soul with continued meekness? Let us pray. Let us stand and we'll close in prayer as well. Father, we thank you so much for tonight. And God, I think tonight's scripture is such a great reminder for us to be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to anger. God, tonight I think you are reminding us of that meekness we need when it comes to hearing your word, when it comes to spending time with you. Father, I pray that you would help us to recall what that was like, hearing certain things from your word and experiencing it for the very first time. God, would you remind us of that joy? God, would you remind us of that breakthrough? Remind us of that light just kind of going off in our minds and in our hearts. And Father, with that familiarity, God, with those memories, God, I pray that you would continually stir up within us a desire to know you more. God, would we have a desire, a passion to seek you with meekness? God, to be overwhelmed, to be blown away, God, by your wondrous majesty. And Father, I pray that you would remove the things in our lives that might hinder us from hearing your word. God, would you remove the sin? God, give us a conviction to battle the sin that prevents us from interacting with you in a way that is fruitful, in a way that leads to your righteousness being increased in our lives. Father, I pray that you would just stir up a hunger and an interest, a continued desire just to know your word more and more. And so, Father, the surface is great. And God, what we're able to experience there is cool and everything. But Father, would you allow us to experience the joys of digging deeper into your word more and more. And now we just ask that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and that the everlasting love of God the Father and that the wisdom, the anointing, the power, the Holy Spirit allow us to leave here to seek you from a place of meekness. God, help us to be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger as we leave your house until we meet again. We ask all these things in your Son's precious name. Amen and amen. May you go in peace. Thank you, church.